was Joseph of Arimathea and a man named Nicodemus. And if you have a Bible, you can turn with me to John chapter 19. You can also pull that up on your iPad or iPhone if you're able to get the service in here. And as we turn to John chapter 19, we read about two incredible characters that pop off the page that we could easily relate to. Now, both Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus are historically connected in all four gospel accounts to the burial of Jesus. And so that's what we're going to focus on this morning. We're going to look at the events of the crucifixion leading to the burial of Christ and the resurrection, and how the cross of Jesus Christ redeemed the focus of these two very prominent Jewish men who were influential in the Jewish hierarchy. As we turn to John chapter 19, we are going to start by looking at verse 38. And as we set our sights on this verse, it's important to realize the enormity of the events that are taking place. In fact, verse 38 starts off just like this. It says, after this. And you could just underline that phrase and put a hash right next to it. We're going to talk a lot about what just took place in just a moment. The Apostle John says, and after this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, but notice, secretly for fear of the Jews. And so we're introduced to a character by the name of Joseph of Arimathea. It's important to realize that in the Bible we have several men named Joseph, and all of them, I would label them as people you wouldn't generally pick to be the hero of a story in the Bible, but because of perseverance and trust, they emerge as incredible characters for us to learn from. Joseph of Arimathea, and we have a slide that I want you to see, is mentioned in all four Gospels. And this is what we're told about him. In Matthew's Gospel, we're told that he's a rich man. And as we study historical proof outside the Bible, we find out that Joseph of Arimathea was the third wealthiest man in Israel. An incredible amount of wealth he had. We're told in Mark's Gospel that he was a prominent council member of the Sanhedrin. He was a part of the council that ultimately condemned Christ to death on the cross. We find out from Luke's gospel, that's why Luke says that he was a good and just man. Luke said that he did not consent to the torture and crucifixion of Christ. So that's very interesting. He's one of several Sanhedrin members, and he and Nicodemus are the lone men we find out that say that it was unjust to crucify Christ, that their claims were wrong. And of course, John's gospel labels him a secret disciple. So what's this all about this morning? Well, we find out here from John's gospel about this man, Joseph of Arimathea, that he was a disciple. You want to underline that word disciple. That word disciple in the Greek language, if you had to just go dig down deep, it means that he was a follower of Jesus. But really, by the next statement of John, but secretly for fear of the Jews, he was a follower, but perhaps more, he was more like a fan. He was a fan, like he did not want to step forward and let anybody else know about his faith. Perhaps only the disciples knew, and perhaps Nicodemus knew. And the Bible says that, John says that he did not step forward basically in his faith for fear of the Jews. Now, what fear did he have? Fear of public scrutiny. In their day and age, if you aligned yourself with Jesus, you could lose all your wealth. You could lose everything you had. You could even possibly pay with your life as Christ would be crucified. And so for fear of the Jews, for fear of his position, for fear of public scrutiny, for fear of whatever else was going on in his heart, he was a secret disciple, a secret fan of Jesus. And that's how it is in our lives. You know, we're fans of the things of God, but sometimes we're not willing to step forward for God because it's somewhat of an inconvenience to us in some way. The problem here is that Joseph of Arimathea, at this point in his walk with God, lacked focus on what was right, what needed to be in his life. And it says this, we hear he was a secret disciple for fear of the Jews. Then the next line says this, and then he asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him permission, so he took the body, and Nicodemus did it with him. Now, wait a minute. John says at one time this man was a secret disciple. John's talking about past tense. As we study the Greek, we learn that. And then we go from John saying he's a secret disciple, and the next line says he asked Pilate for the body. What happened here? What caused, and this has always been a question of mine, what caused a man who was secret in his faith, who did believe, but for fear of whatever, you just, all of the above, everything in between, he did not step forward. But what changed? What caused this man and this other man, Nicodemus, to step out of their fear, to follow God in an amazing way, so much so that he asked Pontius Pilate for the body? I'm going to tell you what it was. It was the cross. They were eyewitnesses to Jesus Christ being tortured and being crucified. They saw it with their own eyes, and it changed their heart forever. They were never the same. They became totally different people. They were once controlled by their fears, no more. Doesn't that describe us sometimes in our life? We let our fears control us, whether it be with family or career, and especially with faith. The Bible says we walk by faith, not by sight. And see, the only thing that could redeem your focus, the only thing that could energize your faith, I wish it could be a pill you could take, you know, and we can offer them today after service. Somebody would charge a lot of money for those pills, I'm sure. I wish it was, you know what, just get baptized again and we'll bless the water. And then when you come out of the baptismal, you're going to have a great focus for God. Don't work like that. You know what, here's a book, 5 Steps to Having a Great Focus. It don't work like that. It's the cross. It's focusing on what Christ went through on our behalf. Now, through this series, we've been looking at historical proof that speaks to the validity of the cross and the resurrection. It's overwhelming. I've concluded just 3 weeks into this series, and if you've missed a few messages, I encourage you the importance of being a church. You can go back on the website and watch all 3 of the messages since Easter. And I'm convinced it takes more faith to be an atheist than it does a Christian. The proof that talks about the life of Christ and the crucifixion and the resurrection is just overwhelmingly comforting to our hearts. In addition to having historical proof, we have medical testimony that speaks to the torture of Christ and the crucifixion of Christ. You know, some people, especially critics, like to assert that, you know, Jesus, his body was stolen off the cross. Well, that's impossible. We talked about that last week. Another theory that people like to throw out there was he survived the crucifixion. If we know anything about Roman beatings and the brutality of crucifixion, nobody survives a beating, let alone a crucifixion. And so what I did was I researched a doctor. And this doctor, he's an expert physician, and he's also a scientific researcher and a historian. He's well documented. You could just go on the internet and look him up. Look him up on Wikipedia if you'd like. He's been published dozens and dozens of times, especially in the medical field, Dr. Alexander Murtherill, and he talks in detail in his writings. He examined the torture of Christ, and he examined the crucifixion. So again, what changed Joseph of Arimathea? Let me read to you his findings. And obviously we know the facts, but it's powerful sometimes to read it and to hear it. This is what he talks about. He talked about the beatings that Christ took before the cross, known as Roman floggings. They were known to be terribly brutal, the doctor says. They usually consisted of 39 lashes, but frequently a lot more were given, depending on the mood of the soldier who applied the blows. It says the soldier would use a whip of braided leather, thongs with metal balls woven into them. When the whip would strike the flesh, these balls would cause deep bruises or contusions, which would break open and cause further blows deep within. And the whip had pieces of sharp bone as well, which would cut deeply into the flesh and cause severe bleeding. Now the back would be so shredded apart that the spine would sometimes be exposed by the deep, deep cuts and the whipping that would go on. And it would continue from the feet to the lower legs, to the buttocks, all the way to the shoulders that this beating would take place. He goes on to say in his writings, one physician who has studied Roman beatings said, as the flogging continued, the lacerations would tear the underlying skeletal muscles and produce quivering ripples of bleeding flesh. A third century historian by the name of Eusebius described the flogging as this: the sufferer's veins would be laid bare and his very muscles and bowels of the victim would be open to exposure. He goes on to say, we know many people would die from this kind of beating even before they were crucified. At least the victim would experience tremendous pain and go into something, a medical term, called hypovolemic shock. And the doctor explains this, and if you were to go research this as well, the hypo means low, the V-O-L obviously means volume, and then the epic means blood. There would be a severe loss of blood, and this would go on to cause the heart to race to try to pump blood that isn't there. Secondly, it would cause the person to lose an enormous amount of blood and actually lead to them fainting if possible. This would explain Jesus carrying part of his cross up to Golgotha where he would be crucified, that he fell to the ground and the Roman soldier ordered a man by the name of Simeon to carry his cross to Calvary. That would explain that. And because of the terrible beatings and the effects, there's no question that Jesus was already in serious critical condition even before the nails were driven through his hands and his feet. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, once secret disciples, are witnessing what's going on. They're witnessing our Lord being beaten. You know, for us, sometimes it's hard, but with 2,000 years have passed, and, you know, obviously a movie was done in 2004, and we watched that, but still, it's sometimes hard for us to imagine. And it's hard for us to stay focused, but what keeps us focused is that the Lord suffered for you and I. That it was his love that took him there. That this faith that we have is much more than a religion. And for crying out loud, it's not just some phony baloney game we play on Sundays. Rather, it's something we take deep to our heart because we know God so loved the world that he gave his son. That's not just a verse we pull out when we first become a believer, but that needs to become the focal point of our life. And when we lose focus of what Christ did, it's very easy to become excuse-oriented. It's very easy to let our commitment to God slip. It's very easy to let other things become more important than our pursuit of God. It's very easy to become cheap when it comes to the things of God. It's very easy to let pleasures dominate our life instead of the purposes of God. And then we have the agony of the cross that the doctor talks about. He says this, it would have began this way. His hands would have been nailed to an outstretched position, the doctor said, to a horizontal beam. This crossbar was called the pendulum, and it was this stage where they would separate the vertical beam from the horizontal beam. And that horizontal beam was permanently in the ground, the vertical rather, and then they would put him on that horizontal. And they would nail him here to the cross, the doctor says. And those nails, you might think, well, how can they hold them? The doctor goes on to tell us research shows that they were 5 inches long and 2 inches thick. And they would drive that through him. The doctor goes on to say as he hung on that cross, the pain was absolutely unbearable. In fact, it was literally beyond words to describe. They had to invent a word, and the word was called excruciating. The word we have today, excruciating, is from the root meaning of out of the cross. Imagine that. They had to invent a word. It was so terrible of a torture. And it goes on to say that the torture on the cross would come to his nerves being crushed. And every time he would try to lift himself up, he would put enormous pressure on his heart and his lungs and his chest cavities. And ultimately, the Lord would surrender his life. And the doctor explains this was the torture and the crucifixion. What changed Joseph of Arimathea? What changed his focus? His focus was changed by witnessing the cross. His focus was changed by witnessing the love of God. What should change us every Sunday? should be getting reacquainted as we sing the songs, as we hear the message of what the faith is all about. What should keep us coming, keep us serving, keep us committed is not what God could do for us, but remembering what God has already done for us. That should be the heart of Christianity and the heart of the message. All the other truths and all the other studies and doctrines will not hold in your life unless your focus is on the cross. What changed for these men was the cross. And what needs to change for you and I in our lives, if we're going to remain focused on God, is the cross. Goes on to say that they took the body. He asks Pilate for the body. Now, the fact that he was able to go right into Pilate's presence, that's what the grammar explains to us, tells us that this man, Joseph of Arimathea, had a lot of pull, a lot of clout, that he can go right into the presence of Pilate. So he goes right into the presence of Pilate. He asks for the body of Jesus. Pilate gives him the body. It actually says he gave him. That's the only reference to this word gave in this tense in the Greek in the entire Bible. It means that he gave it willingly and understandingly. Apparently, Joseph of Arimathea must have explained his faith to Pilate. He must have said to him at one point, I was on the outside looking in. At one point, my public image was more important than what the Messiah was teaching. But because I saw what he did on the cross, he said to Pilate, it changed everything. Apparently, because Pilate gave him permission to take the body. And Joseph is a very wealthy man, a very influential man, but all of that means nothing right now. He asks for the body. And so he came, and circle the word, took. He took the body. Now again, we read this very quickly. Took the body like he was delivered UPS or something like that. Or they had a funeral over down at Colonial over there. You know, they had a three-day funeral. That's not what happened. Jesus was on the cross. We heard about his beatings. We heard about his torture. Nicodemus, along with a few other helpers, went to the cross. Nicodemus holding the ladder. Joseph of Arimathea, the third wealthiest man in Israel, climbing to the ladder with a crowbar, prying the nails of Jesus out. And Jesus just all bloodied up and beaten up. Just imagine him taking the nail out of Jesus' hand, and then Jesus with one arm, a dead body. Could he have weighed 200 pounds perhaps or something like that? Picture a 200-pound dead man, part of his body, loafing over you as you're on the cross, the ladder being held, all the blood and the spit on Joseph now. This is the work of a man whose focus has been redeemed. This is not the work of a man who's just a fan. This is not the work of a man who lets convenience dictate his life. This is the work of a man now whose focus is firmly on God. And he's up there and he's taking Jesus off the cross. Before we go any further, I want you to write this principle down, because a principle now emerges. Once a fearful man of whatever public image, you just name it, once a man who was a fan of Jesus and the things he did, now a man who goes and asks for the body, and a man who's taking the blood in Jesus off the cross with his bare hands. I want you to write this principle down. We have to step past fear by removing obstructions to the cross. And obstructions could be a number of different things, as we mentioned earlier. There could be things in your life right now, even some good things, that are getting in the way of you seeing what it's all about. You can be 15, you can be 55, you can be 85, it don't matter how young or old you are. You're never too young and you're never too old to start focusing on God Almighty. I can make you this promise though, you will not get to the end of your life and go, what a waste of time it was for me to focus on God. What a waste of time it was for me to be touched by the cross. Again, this is more than mere religion. What is religion anyway, if you think about it, in our culture in Staten Island? Religion is another word for payday, okay? You want to do a sacrament? Got to pay for it. You want to get married in the church? Oh, you have a pass? We can't do it. What do you do for a living? Okay, we'll expedite that request, okay? $5,000 donation. That's what religion has become, a pay-as-you-go system. And as you pay, or as you do, we'll allow you to get closer to God. Because we control that. On the contrary, it's by His grace He went to the cross. By His grace, we are accepted. That's what it's all about. This is more than man-made religious con systems that actually discourage people from the cross. It doesn't help them see it. On the contrary, Joseph of Arimathea stepped past his fears because the obstructions for him was his money, was his image. You may not be like Joseph of Arimathea today, but what's your obstructions? What's getting in the way of you? I know a few of mine. I've already written them down. What are some of your obstructions that get in the way? As the good doctor explained, that torturous event of the whipping and then the crucifixion changed Joseph Arimathea and Nicodemus. And they took the body. And as he pried open one nail and it came off, and the body of Christ, picture all the blood atop of Joseph. And as he probably took one arm with another arm, getting the nail loose, his arms now on the back of Christ, open and bare to that wooden cross. What was it like for Joseph to hold Jesus that way? What did it do to him? How did it change him? Joseph with the body of Jesus. And so he took the body, and it says, and Nicodemus. And now we're introduced to another character who's prominent in the Bible and history as well. A man by the name of Nicodemus, who at first came to Jesus at night. He also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pounds. Now, I just need to just quickly tell you this because I want to move on. That is extremely costly. This is not a burial fit for a criminal. This is a burial fit for a king. And you could not afford these things if you were middle class or if you were poor. You needed to be extremely wealthy. And both Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus were extremely wealthy men. Joseph of Arimathea is the muscle. He's taking Jesus off the cross with his bare hands. Nicodemus is supplying the supplies. And they're going to give this man who they knew was a king, now they fully have declared it outright, they're going to give him a proper burial. And they're going to do it themselves. They could have hired people. They're rich, wealthy people. But they themselves wanted to roll up their sleeves and handle the body of Jesus. They wanted to be personally invested. This wasn't just playtime for them. They were changed. They stepped past their fear. What do you need to step past today? Is it your past? Haven't you realized yet that Christ has paid for it full on the cross? Is it your weaknesses that you think God can't possibly use me? Sure He can. In fact, the Bible says His grace is perfected in our weakness. Is it your wounds that have been caused by the past of things people have done to you or self-inflicted wounds? Remember, the Bible says that God binds up the brokenhearted. He has healing grace that He offers. Joseph of Arimathea stepped past all of that because he saw the cross clearly that Good Friday. Because he experienced the earthquake. He experienced the darkness that fell over the earth. You know, some people like to try to say, well, the darkness and the earthquake, did that really happen? Did they just throw that in? Well, we have some secular historians who tell us differently. First, notice what Tertullian says. This man was actually a Christian, but we're going to go on to secular historians. But first, the Christian historian Tertullian says, darkness as a cosmic was a cosmic and world event, speaking of 33 AD. We go on to Julius Africanus. Again, these are historians that you can go Google. And he talks about, in his work, that on the whole world there was pressed a most fearful darkness, and the rocks were rent by an earthquake, and many places in Judea and other districts were thrown down. And we find out from another historian, Flagian, he says, in 33 AD, there was the greatest eclipse of the sun, and that it became night in the sixth hour of the day, so that the stars even appeared in the heavens, and there was a great earthquake. He wrote this in his study of world history at the time. call the Olympiads. And these are secular historians notating that darkness fell over the earth. And so Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, with their bare hands, stepping forward to do these things. And I'd like to highlight for you the process of their heart. And I like to call this redemption's process of focus right there in your outline. This is how it went for them. This is how it goes for us. At some point or another, we're controlled by fear. Fear to step forward. Perhaps today for you, it's fear to believe in Jesus Christ for whatever reason. Maybe it's fear to take a step forward in your life with Christ. Maybe it's a step that you're putting off. It's fear is controlling you. The Bible says that we haven't been given a spirit of fear, that a spirit of fear has been replaced with a spirit of faith. The Bible says perfect love casts out what? All fear. And so the perfect love of Christ, that's what John is saying on the cross, who was an eyewitness to the cross, casts out all fear. So at first it's fear. And then we move into a fanfare relationship with Jesus. We like him. We like what the Bible says. We like the things of God. We support it from afar, but we're not ready to step forward. And then what happens is whether there's an event in our life or we get reacquainted or more acquainted with the Bible, we become people of faith. We place our faith in Jesus Christ, and then from there we become at some point a follower. I believe that's what happened for Joseph of Arimathea. It happened on a fast track, and I believe the reason why was the cross. The cross changed his perspective. My friends, that's what's going to change our perspective in this life. When we focus upon the things of God and what Christ has done for us, Christianity will not become old hat. It won't become just some holiday we celebrate every once in a while. Rather, it will become something that we stand firm on. And so Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus taking the body of Jesus off the cross. Verse 40 goes on to say this. Then they took the body of Jesus and bound it in strips of linen with the spices, as was the custom of the Jews to bury. And we find out from another secular historian by the name of Josephus, he actually confirms that this is the way that Jewish people buried. They believed in having a proper burial and wrapping people a certain way. And if you were to study Jewish culture today, there's something called the Hevro Kedisha. And I ran into somebody not too long ago. I heard about their experience. Their family member was close to dying in Israel. And so the brother, the son of the family, flew out to Israel to be with the father. And after the father died, the Hevro Kedisha came in. It's still a society today. And they comb the hair, they clean the body, whatever wounds there may have been, and they wrap the body and they show complete love and sincerity. And I can almost picture God in heaven, the Father going, my son was in cruel hands, and now he's being taken care of with precious hands. Think about it in your own life. If somebody in your life has passed, you wouldn't want the body of somebody you loved being trampled upon after they died. You would want it to be held with tender, loving hands. What if it was my son? What if it was your son? And God said, no more cruel hands on my son. Joseph and Nicodemus and the women were tenderly cleaning the wounds of Jesus. And then they wrapped him in those beautiful, clear as day white linens. And I like to think of this as Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus serving Jesus. And so write this last principle down before we close. Serve Jesus with a heart of contribution. Serve Jesus with a heart of contribution. Here were these two extremely wealthy men, influential men. They could care less anymore about that. They've asked for the body. They've taken the body down, and now with their bare hands, they have cleaned the body of the Lord. We get upset if somebody asks us to do something. We make excuses every time God wants to use us. I don't have enough time. I don't have enough resources. I don't have enough talent. And we bring out the whole list of excuses. These men could have used excuses, but they didn't. We go on to learn from other historians that Nicodemus died a poor man. How could Nicodemus die a poor man? He was one of the wealthiest men in Israel because they didn't have policemen and laws that protected them. Nicodemus's wealth and all of his resources was seized. We know from another secular historian that Nicodemus, prior to this event of the crucifixion, his daughter had one of the most opulent weddings in the history of Israel. Almost like when the prince got married about a year ago, and they cut in on all your programs, and here comes this car. Oh, there's this one, and that one was invited. Who cares, you know? People were getting up at 3 in the morning to watch it. Some of you, I think, were doing that. But. And so, I was just kidding. I guess a couple of you did, okay? And here Nicodemus, an extremely wealthy man, his daughter has one of the biggest weddings, most opulent weddings ever, and he dies a poor man. Because he was willing to lose it all for Christ. He stepped forward and now he's serving with his life. That is the call of the faith. And you know what? For you, it may not be that you're going to lose everything. Maybe God's going to increase your capacities because he knows that he could trust you. I'm not saying I know how everybody's life's going to work out. I'd be a fool if I did that. But that this much I do know is that God has called us to serve him from our heart with a heart of contribution, because the cross demands that from us. God is calling us to take Christ in our own way, just as Joseph and Nicodemus did, to care for the least of these, to care for the hurting, to care for the widow and the orphan, to care for those who are traded in sex trafficking, to care for the handicapped, for the autism, to care for those with HIV. You know what the church has become in America? It's become like a stinking museum, right? It's like a museum. Don't walk here, don't do this. Oh, this one's coming to church now. That's what it's become, like a museum for the saints. It's not a museum, it's a hospital. It's a sending ground. It's a training ground. It's a place where we come to give worship to God, to be fed in his word, to grow in our faith, ultimately what? So we can show the love of the cross. And whether that's to your neighbor next door, or your brother or sister who lives with you, or your family member, or mother, or father, or son, or whether it's across the seas of the world, wherever it is, God has called us to serve Jesus with a heart of contribution, because God gave first to us. In fact, we're told repeatedly that it's more blessed to give than it is to receive. You will never be more fulfilled in your life than when you serve like Jesus and when you serve him. You will never feel more fulfilled. I mean, look at Joseph of Arimathea, the third wealthiest man in Israel. He lacked fulfillment. He lacked focus. But the cross changed it all. And it says now in verse 41, in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden. And in the garden, a new tomb, which no one had yet been laid. And so there Jesus was laid, because the Jews' preparation day for the tomb was nearby. This tomb, as we find out from the other gospels, it had to be carved out, hewed out. They didn't have power tools then. You know how much wealth you had to have to hire men to do that? Joseph had that tomb ready to go for Jesus. What makes this significant biblically and historically is that Joseph of Arimathea is a living prophecy. You know, I would gather today, if Joseph was interviewed by somebody like Larry King or Chris Matthews or even that other joker, Bill Maher, and they brought him on there, and they would say, Joseph, do you really believe that he rose from the dead? And you know what Joseph would say? We do, because we handled the body, and the same body that we laid in the tomb and the same cloths that we put on him. On the third day, we saw that the tomb was empty and that the linens that we wrapped him in were laying on the stone. We saw it with our own eyes, Larry. Bill, you got to stop making jokes, Bill, because it's real. Because guess what, Bill? He's coming again. He's coming again to judge the living and the dead. And no matter who you are, you need to get your heart right. You're going to be skeptical, but be skeptical with legitimacy. Because Joseph of Arimathea is a living prophecy. And you know what? I bet you Larry King or somebody would have said to him, Joseph, do you really believe the Bible's literal? And you know what Joseph would have said? I do, because I am a literal prophecy. Isaiah 53, verse 9. You could turn there, but allow me to read it for you for sake of time. And they made his grave with the wicked. They did not make his grave with the wicked, but with the rich at his death. And you might say, what's significant about that? Well, that's written from the book of Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 53. Oh, of course it's going to say that. It's the Bible. Well, it's also a historical document now. Because in 1947, a little shepherd boy was over by the Dead Sea, and he found some scrolls in jars wrapped in leather. He took those jars, and he thought, you know what? I can make a little money with this. So he took it to a shoemaker, their equivalency of a shoemaker, sandal maker or whatever. And he got about a day's worth of salary if you were a fisherman for that. And that must have seemed like a fortune to that young man. Somebody then took those things and sold them for $250 in our equivalency. And then somebody took those scrolls a third time and sold them for $250,000. And then somebody took those scrolls and they purchased them for about $5 million. Here's the point. Well, here's one of the points of this story. If you find any jars with leather in them under the boardwalk, don't take them to Payless, okay? You don't know what they are, okay? But in all seriousness, these Dead Sea Scrolls contain fragments of the Old Testament. And you know what else we have in those Dead Sea Scrolls? The entire book of Isaiah. Imagine that. All 66 chapters. This is the oldest biblical discovery on the face of the earth. And with their testing and with their chronology of events historically mentioned in the book, it dates back to 100 BC. If you're keeping score, if you're a skeptic, that's 100 years before crucifixion was ever done. And it talks about crucifixion. This is where you say wow again. A little bit more convincing. Okay? And if that wasn't enough, the book was written 700 years before Christ. And it predicts the birth of Christ, and it predicts the crucifixion, the suffering of Christ, and it predicts with precision that a rich man would open up his tomb for Jesus. That's who we're reading about today. That's God. That's why you can trust this record. That's why if Joseph and Nicodemus were sitting across from a skeptic or a doubter, they would say, we believe because we are a literal fulfillment of a prophecy that was written 700 years before our life. We get bugged out if we hear a knock in the attic. We think it's our lucky day if all the lights are green on Highland Boulevard. We're very mystical people. We're ready to play the lotto if we find $20 somewhere, okay? How did Joseph feel that he was a literal fulfillment of God's prophecy? How did it change his heart? I believe that it all came into focus for Joseph that Good Friday. I believe that he was forever changed. History goes on to tell us that Joseph would be sent by Philip and he would take the gospel to England. He would also go to a place in Glutenbury, Somersetshire, where he would preach the very first sermon in that area where thousands would get saved. He built a pulpit out of twigs and wood, and you can go there today and there's a chapel named in his honor. He was forever changed for God. He stepped forward. They stepped forward from their fear to serve God. I want to close by telling you today that God wants you to step forward into maturity today. How many of you ever rode a bike when you were younger with training wheels? Remember that time when mom or dad or grandma or grandpa or your older sibling took the training wheels off, and how did it feel to go off on your own? Felt real good, right? I got some training wheels here. And I want to encourage you today. Today is the day you take the training wheels off your life. Today's the day you step forward. Today's the day if maybe today you need to open up your heart to Christ and step past your fear and your troubles. He loved you, died on the cross, he rose from the dead. Take the wheels off today. They're holding you back. Maybe today for you it's to become a member of the church, a partner in the church, and stop being on the outside looking in. Maybe for you it's to be more committed in your faith, to better church attendance, whatever it might be in your life. Everybody's different, but guess what? We don't condemn anybody because we all need God's grace. We all need the training wheels taken off at some point. Joseph of Arimathea was forever changed. The training wheels of his life came off, and he went from fear to fan to faith to follower. Let me ask you a question today. Are you a follower of Jesus Christ? Do you believe in him as your Lord and your Savior? Do you trust in him that, you know what, if it ended today, you'd close your eyes, you'd wake up in heaven because of Christ? And are you willing to live for Christ? Are you willing to take the life of Christ in your school, your work, your home? Are you willing to be like Joseph of Arimathea and step past your drama and remove those obstructions? Are you ready to serve Jesus? Are you ready to follow him, knowing that there will be no regrets? My friends, I can't wait to get to heaven to talk to Joseph of Arimathea. I'm going to ask him what it was like. Did he hear the words, "It is finished"? Did he hear the words, my God, why have you forsaken me?" But I know what words he did hear when he got to heaven. "Well done, good and faithful servant." Let that be said of us, that we want to serve God in such a way because of the cross, not for any other reason.